Apparently it's too slow to load. Hey, holosexuals hot or whatever, Monique. Hopefully you're ever so often it says that it's connecting or something's wrong. Since today was an I just wanted to go one by one and kind of go through the sort of stuff that we're deal with in the emergency department. So my first patient today was a 56-year-old female with foot pain. She had foot pain for 2 or 3 days. She had woken up with the pain, and it was her heel mostly. So definitely not an emergency, no fever, no chills, nausea, no vomiting. The pain was localized to the heel, not really the plantar side. There was no swelling with it. I did an x-ray that did confirm a spur, but I'm not sure that was the whole where the pain was coming from. I palpated over the heel spur, and that wasn't tender at all. So it's probably more, she did have some degenerative joint disease around the heel. So I told her it's probably overuse and pain from inflammation. She was given some steroids. I recommended those heel by Dr. Scholes that have the hole in the middle. It's basically like a donut to help relieve the pressure on that heel. And of course, follow up with an orthopedic doctor, give her some steroids, some pain medicine. Hi from Australia, Sue Roker and Puppy Saver. Good evening, Missouri. Thank you. Second patient of the day, I did not write what that one was. 55-year-old, so I'm gonna skip that one. Next patient was flu-like symptoms and sore throat. Basically, she had a sore throat and body aches, fever and feverish since the day before. And she didn't look toxic or anything, but the story sounded like flu versus strep when I did look at the throat. Where'd you go?
That's a little thing.
Thank you so much. When I did look at the throat, the uvula was swollen and red. There was no exudates and no tonsillitis. She actually did not have tonsils. Well, I did the flu test, negative. I did the strep test, positive. And she was like, I can get strep? Of course you can get strep. You just don't get tonsillitis, because if you had a tonsillectomy, you can't get tonsillitis anymore, but you can still have strep. Now remember, 5% of the population is strep positive. They carry strep in their throats. Doesn't mean they have the disease, but she actually had soft palate swelling and throat pain and body aches. So I treated her just plain amoxicillin, gave her some steroids that'll help with the swelling, soreness, and pain. And that was that. Next patient was a 21-year-old female who ran out of her blood sugar medicines, and she was acting up. She was 350s at home. She was 300 when I saw her. She's just out of her glybura and metformin. She didn't have nausea, vomiting, abdominal pain, or anything like that. So all I did for her, we check her sugar here, was 300. I gave her a dose of insulin sub-Q just to kind of track her down. Wrote a prescription for her glybura, for her metformin, gave her refills, encouraged her to find a primary doctor in the area. And she went home. She was happy. Hey, Jennifer Albert, thank you for saying that about my videos. And thank you, Sue Roker. Why are they so against taking tonsils out? Well, it's surgery. You don't want to do it if you don't want to. There's complications associated with tonsillectomies. I knew I had a whole bunch of sore throats when I was little. I begged my dad, he's a pediatrician, take the tonsils out. I'm tired of getting sore throats. He never did. I'm glad I didn't. Why put a kid at necessary risk? I had simple tonsillitis, no abscess, no anything. I wasn't deadly sick, so I just took antibiotics and that was it. So don't jump into aggressive surgery if you don't have to. So that was the blood sugar patient. Then I saw a 25-year-old with chest pain. No, her chest pain, yeah. 17, got it. Patient needs pain medicine. What a surprise, huh? So chest pain. 22-year-old female with chest pain. You know, the early patients with chest pain, you have to make sure that you go through a differential diagnosis, including pulmonary embolism, pericarditis or myocarditis. Heart attacks, very unlikely. You want to assure them they don't have a collapsed lung. So this is a young female, small, with some reproducible chest pain. So of course I did a chest x-ray, was fine. EKG, no pericarditis, no extra heartbeats or arrhythmias. And on the blood work, of course, I did a troponin. Troponin is the blood test to look at heart attacks, but I wasn't expecting that to show anything. The most important test probably in the blood work was a D-dimer, and a D-dimer is a test that, if positive, increases your possibility of it being blood clot.
Hey, the girl in 30 said you were going to give her something for itching. Do you know anything about
I thought
that?
I did.
I didn't see it, but I may have overlooked it. I was just helping, and she, maybe I just overlooked it.
I did order.
Nope. Okay. All right. And she wants to know if she's going to go home?
Oh, yeah.
Okay.
I already wrote her. She's up in the chart.
Oh, is she? Oh, okay. All right. Well, she said she'd been calling like 3 times. I went in there to see what she wanted.
Yeah, the chart's over there for discharge.
Yeah. Okay.
Sorry about that, guys. So where was I? Chest pain in young ladies. So D-dimer. So D-dimer was negative. Chest X-ray was negative. EKG was fine. Blood was fine. I just gave her some anti-inflammatories. I was able to reproduce the pain on palpation. So I call it costochondritis. Costo for ribs. Dryness for inflammation of the ligaments, and she went home. This was a good story. 57-year-old, this is a really, really sad story. Somebody asked a question about dilaudid. It already went off the screen, but do I prescribe dilaudid in the ER? Very, very rarely. I prescribe it for cancer patients, kidney stones that I can't get the pain under control. Patients who are on chronic pain medicine have an acute fracture or something really objective, but otherwise, no, I don't prescribe dilaudid. So these have this 50 something year old man who looks much older than stated age. His story goes, he's been coughing, wheezing, congested for weeks, but he had not been to the doctor because his wife, who has ALS, amyotrophic lateral sclerosis, has been on nursing care for a long time, was just put on hospice. Well, that's just a sad, sad story, right? So he finally was able to come to the ER. It sounded like a simple bronchitis, maybe an early pneumonia, but he had SIRS criteria, systemic inflammatory response syndrome. Because of that, we did blood cultures, antibiotics, gave some fluids, breathing treatments, steroids, the works. The chest X-ray showed likely pneumonia, but not just any pneumonia, cavitary pneumonia. Cavitary pneumonia means that there's almost like a hole, like the pneumonia is eating up the tissue. All right. And then there was this other thing in the lower part of the lobe that looked like a mass. So we did a CT scan with contrast, and that's it. He has pneumonia and he has a lung mass, probably cancer. And he has lesions also found in the CAT scan on the adrenal gland. So he probably has metastatic primary lung disease. He didn't even know about it. He just came for a bronchitis and coughing. He's only 57 years old. So that's super sad. So when I told him about it, we had to bring the patient in. Hi, Kimberly Brunette. To you. So we had to bring him in. He said, yeah, but can I go to visit my wife? I mean, that's just sad. So what we did is something we normally don't do. I go ahead and took the IV out, let him go, but he had to be back within the hour or else we had to close up the chart. And he went, did what he needed to do, came back to the ER, and then we admitted him. And we'll see when we end up with him. Next patient, 49-year-old, cold, congestion, flu-like symptoms. I actually do not remember the specific of this particular case, but probably did a chest X-ray, gave a breathing treatment, she felt better and went home. So nothing, I'm not gonna get into that too much. Room 8 was a right arm. Oh yeah, yeah, that's a good one. That's a good one. This lady came with redness that you can palpate a hardening spot all the way to their medial elbow right here. You can palpate through. And that's usually something called superficial thrombophlebitis. Superficial because it's superficial layers. Thrombo as in clot, and phlebitis because it's a blood vessel. So inflammation of the blood vessels from thrombus. But she had no IVs. Usually that happens if people were in the hospital recently, got an IV, IV injections. But it could also be from trauma. So we did an ultrasound. Not, I knew she had superficial thrombophlebitis, but what I wanted to answer was she didn't have a deeper clot, a DVT, deep vein thrombosis, because that's treated with aggressive anticoagulation. So the ultrasound was negative for that, and we gave her some anti-inflammatories, warm compress, and go home. Now, on the ultrasound, they found that she might have a little mass or lesion in her thyroid. Now, if it ends up being cancer of the thyroid, that would explain why she has a higher incidence of thrombosis and clots. So that's not something, even though we found that mass, my job as an emergency physician is not to diagnose everything, But what's the emergency? Cancer, unless it's compromising the airway, is not really an emergency diagnosis. So I didn't go into that. We just told her about it. She's followed up with the primary care doctor, get all the tests. And that was that. That was a good, interesting one. Then was a 28-year-old who presented to emergency department with sinus congestion, history of upper respiratory infection, and then symptoms of dizziness. And when people say dizzy, you want to differentiate. Is it that they're feeling lightheaded or they feel like they're spinning? And sometimes the patient don't even can't tell you what they feel. But eventually I got it to say that, yeah, if I move a certain way, it gets worse, feels like I'm spinning. So I went ahead and did a CT head, which confirmed that no mass, no tumors, no bleeding. I did a little bit of blow, make sure she wasn't diabetic or her electrolytes were off, and those were fine. Gave her some meclizine, which is Antivert, is the medical, the brand name, Antivert, and she felt better. So she went home on Antivert, some nausea medicine, and that was that. Then I saw a lady who came with very elevated blood pressures. I mean, she had blood pressure 200 over 110. Now, normal's 120 over 80. Actually, the American Heart Association said that now we should be targeting 115 over 75. So with that elevated blood pressure and symptoms of it, like a headache, dyspnea, shortness of breath, maybe some palpitations, I did some basic blood work, CBC for blood count, electrolytes, and a troponin for the heart. Make sure there's no heart attack. Of course, an EKG, make sure there's no ischemic changes. And we gave her a medication for blood pressure. Blood pressure did not buckle with the initial medicine, so I started an IV, gave her some more medication that brought it down. Now, when you're trying to bring the blood pressure down in the ER to send them home, you don't wanna drop it down too much. You only wanna drop it by 1/3. Because if you're up here and you drop into half, then all of a sudden they're lightheaded, they're dizzy, and that's just what happened to this patient. Because she had not responded to previous dose, I gave her a good dose IV, and she went to nearly normal blood pressure. So when she stood up and got ready to go, she got really lightheaded. So we had to sit her down, wait it out until she got better. She left the hospital, left the ER, and apparently after that she had this reaction, she got dizzy, she felt short of breath when she stood up, she was shaky, and then she got left arm numbness. So she came back to the ER later that day with this complaint, so I did a code neuro stroke CT scan that was negative. I repeated some of the blood work, which was fine, but at that point, her pressure was bouncing back up to 190 over 90, so I went ahead on readmitting her to the hospital, to not just the ER, but to the hospital for blood pressure control. And I think what happened was just of a medication reaction. I don't think it was an allergy. I don't think it was a stroke or a mini stroke or TIA. So I ended up admitting her for observation and do other tests to figure out what's going on. Next patient was a 38-year-old with right lower quadrant pain. And she said it was some constipation. Well, she had had a bowel movement a couple days back, but she also had a history of PCOS. What is that? Polycystic ovarian syndrome. And polycystic ovarian syndrome gives you ovarian cysts. Ovarian cysts hurt. So she could have constipation, but more like the unilateral pain that kind of was pretty steady. It's probably ovarian cysts. So we got an ultrasound. She did have cysts, but they weren't very large. I did a KUB, kidneys, ureter, bladder x-ray, just a plain abdominal x-ray, and to look for constipation or obstipation or severe fecal impaction. None of that showed. I did a urine, make sure she didn't have a urinary tract infection. And the urine was kind of dirty, so it wasn't clear cut that she had a UTI. But I went ahead and gave her some antibiotics. Most antibiotics induce diarrhea or water bowel movements anyway, so it'll help with that constipation, and then treated her for possible ovarian cyst and discharge her home. Next patient is 54-year-old with chest pain. This one has some family history of congestive heart failure. She had hypertension history and her pressure was high when she came in. She never had a cardiac workup in the past. Her EKG did not show anything to indicate cardiac ischemia or heart attacks. Her blood work was perfect. Chest x-ray clear and all that, but we admitted her to a hospital. Well, why? I mean, all her blood work was normal, right? Well, what happens is this. Patient has two risk factors, and she's 50, she's female. Females tend to present more atypically than males for acute heart disease. So when there's that, there's some scoring criteria, and they have enough criteria, you should do a more involved rollout than just some enzymes and send them home. Otherwise, you're gonna miss a lot of heart attacks. So, since she's never been worked up, we admit her, we do serial troponins or cardiac markers for heart attacks, and then do some kind of stress testing. It could be the one walking in the machine, it can be the injection, perfusion scan, it can be a stress echo, where we do an ultrasound of the heart as they exercise, so as we increase the heart rate. There's many different ways of doing that rule out. So even though the most likely cause of the patient's chest pain, however, is probably the hypertension. She came in, she was elevated, gave her some medication, went down. So probably it's more likely symptomatic hypertension and not just cardiac or coronary disease. All right, we're almost halfway through the list. The next one came for abnormal labs, and naturally being the sickest guy I saw today. This guy has, instead of a bladder, has a pouch made of intestine where the urine ureters drain too, and he has to put a tube through the abdomen to drain urine ever so many times in a day. They know he has a urinary tract infection that is sensitive to Bactrim, so they've been treating with that at home. Yesterday at home health, they gave him some IV fluids, but they did some blood work today and it was so abnormal, he was sent to the ER to be evaluated. Well, what was so abnormal about it? His CO2 was extremely low. Now, CO2 should be about 20, and his was 6. That indicates he's acidotic. And I did an ABG, and it looked like it wasn't respiratory. It wasn't like he was holding his breath too much and reaccumulating CO2 and turning into acid. Instead, it was metabolic. He was developing the acid from the inside of his own system. So that's called metabolic acidosis. So I gave him some IV fluids. I got in contact with a kidney doctor who would help me work up the acidosis, got the patient admitted to a hospital for further treatment and stuff. And of course, we got to give him things to bring the blood back to normal pH. So from an acidic pH, more basic, we usually give bicarb. And that's how we started the workup. But I didn't get to a definitive diagnosis because I'm the ER doctor. I determined there's a diagnosis, there is a treatment that needs to happen in hospital. I move on to the next patient, I get him into a hospital where they can figure it out later. Next patient, 21-year-old, just short of breath. He was getting the spasms in his back, feeling short of breath when he went up and down the steps. He has this history of some occupational injury, he's on physical therapy, he's short of breath. So again, this is kind of like a 22-year-old with chest pain. This is a young male who doesn't have any cardiac history, any medical problems. So same thing, you do the regular blood work, you do the chest x-ray, EKG. In this case, I had a D-dimer as well. D-dimer was negative. And then everything else was. So Ron Jeremy, that says I'm a liar. I don't know what a liar about what. Oh, they're talking about other stuff. Forget about it. So shortness of breath and his workup was negative. I could not figure it out. Now, if he was 40s, 50s, I would have admitted him for workup, get an echocardiogram, get cardiology consult, things like that. This was a healthier male, no medical problems, and I just discharged him home. Next one, room 29, dizziness. You see the pattern? A lot of medical, non-dangerous stuff. I don't feel like I did much of anything today. I saw a bunch of patients for sure, but I didn't save anybody or anything. Let's skip that one. That one's dizzy. I don't remember. Pregnant lady came in with cramps and pain down there. Anytime you see a pregnant lady come with cramps and pain, you got to make sure the pregnancy is okay. Is it in the right place? Is the baby alive? So she got an internal ultrasound. Baby was fine. Measuring by dates, good heartbeat. We did see, however, that where the pregnancy is implanted, there was a lot of extra blood vessels. And she was having some bloody spotting, so that could be part of that and why she was hurting, but nothing emerging, nothing dangerous at this time. She followed with OBGYN. Then I saw a guy with back pain. This guy was riding an ATV. He's on disability, but he was riding an ATV around the house or on the yard, and lost control. He wouldn't stop, and he ran into a fence, and the ATV came back on top of him like that. So he hurt his back, and guess what? The guy's had 3 previous back surgeries. So he also was having some numbness and pain going down his legs. So with this history of surgeries, I did a CT scan. I didn't even do an X-ray. I went straight to CT scan of the lumbar spine, and nothing. No herniated disc, no fractures, no shifting. Now, he was hurting on his leg, too. I did an X-ray of his femur. It was negative. Had some abrasion of his knee. He didn't have chest pain, he had belly pain, and that was about it. So he went home, some pain medicine, follow up with his back specialist and stuff. There was this guy came later that was a knee pain, and he was holding his knee bent like this, and he said he couldn't straighten it out. He's been going for 2 days. He had spent a lot of time on his knees doing some work, and when he stood up, he felt like something was jammed into his knee. The knee wasn't swollen, wasn't red. It didn't look abnormal at all. Distally, you look at pulses, you look at circulation, you look at sensation, everything was fine. And I could straighten out the knee, but it would just hurt too much. X-rays, I knew X-rays are gonna only show bone, but I needed to do a CT scan. So we did a CT scan of the knee, and it ended up being negative. No soft tissue swelling, no edema, no cracks. But he really needs an MRI, because an MRI will show the soft tissue and the tendon and ligaments. And what I think is happening to him is one of the tendons or ligaments that holds the knee together, probably the meniscal tear. I like that. Nanda rocks, you say meniscus tear. Probably a tear and cause a piece of that meniscus, which is like the little cushion that holds the bones together, it went in. And now he can straighten out. So he'll need an MRI, he'll need to follow up with ortho and probably an arthroscopy to get into that knee joint to look at it and stuff. So that's knee pain. We're down to the last little list, bit of the list. Next one is a pregnant lady. Again, this one came in with a history of UTIs and flank pain and hurting. Her urine was kind of dirty. We did an ultrasound, pregnancy's fine. She needed some IV fluid, she felt better, she went home. This lady's interesting, this one coming up. This was a left lower quadrant abdominal pain. She has history of ascites, or the belly being full of fluid, because she has liver cirrhosis. And she's had multiple drainage, paracentesis. You should look at the videos I have on paracentesis, they're pretty cool. I love doing drainage. But anyway, she had come to the ER earlier today, so non-specific belly pain, was seen, evaluated, discharged. After she left, she had a bunch of diarrhea, and then developed this just collection of fluid. I mean, it's like bumped out almost like a hernia, but it felt like fluid. So I did more blood work to make sure there wasn't any change, and I did a CT scan. And the CT scan just showed abdominal wall edema, basically fluid within the abdominal wall space, suggestive of infection. But she has no ICANS elevation, no fever. The area wasn't red or hot, so I didn't treat it as an infection. Basically, I treated her for the pain and the diarrhea, and I discharged her. Now, I'll be back on Sunday, so that's a day and a half from today. So I told her, come back Sunday, and we'll repeat the blood, can repeat the exam, and see if we need to do any more studies. She felt fine with that, her pain was doing better, so that's what we did. Next one is one that I'm still waiting stuff on. Things are back. I was waiting on the urine. It's a pregnant lady again, with nausea and vomiting, not doing well, some abdominal pain and cramps, and that stuff. And her blood works fine, her urine's fine. I gave her some IV fluid, she didn't go home. The husband, who was sitting there next to her, as I'm examining her, starts vomiting. So he became my patient. Now he's a young man, he's been vomiting, so it's probably the same thing. They probably have a stomach bug, making him cramp up and hurt and getting nauseous and all of everything. So the husband got some IV fluids and nausea medicine and everything else. His blood work wasn't down to normal. He's going home too. She's going home now, so I get to check her off, write her discharge paperwork. The next one I already talked about, which was the lady who came back for me twice, one for high blood pressure, the other for hand numbness. And then I have this lady who's so unfortunate, 76-year-old lady. She had a month ago, she had a shoulder dislocation. She went to follow up with the orthopedic, found she had a rotator cuff tear. And so they made surgery. Before surgery, she was already taking oxycodones. She was already taking morphine 50 milligrams. She had her surgery, and during recovery, she was in terrific pain. So they gave her Dilaudid and fentanyl. Did not work. They would still send her home with that degree of pain. She comes to us just begging me to give her a shot or something, get her pain under control. I gave her an IV, and I gave her 2 milligrams of Dilaudid. Nothing. She says her pain was just the same. She wasn't drowsy. She's 76 years old. Dilaudid is a very, very powerful medicine. And so I gave her another milligram of Dilaudid. Well, at least I order it. Let me see if they gave it. She's been given. And I ordered some fentanyl. So if I go back there, and that's what I'm going to do once I finish the video, and she's still in pain, I'm just going to try to admit her for a pump. Pain medicine pump, and What are they talking about? Doctor needs to retire Moses as a child. Hopefully they're not talking about me. I don't know. I'm reading some of the comments there. It's silly. Hey, Juicy, love your videos. Fair witness, laugh aloud. All right, so anyway, shoulder pain. So I look at the arm. She was a little cold, but good capillary refill. Pulse oximetry on there was fine. The arm looked okay. She just has a lot of shoulder pain from the surgery. So I called the orthopedic. I said, can we just admit her and have anesthesia to another nerve block or something like that? And they didn't feel great about that. They recommended we try to give her pain medicine, just get her better. And anyway, so right now I'm waiting to see if pain's better or not, to see what I'm gonna do. And she's my very last patient. I get to go home. It's 11:04 p.m. I'm done at 11, so I really need to finish. So I'm gonna have to say goodbye. We'll see you next time. For those of you who are here, I've never had this big an audience, 153 people. Thanks for hanging out. George O'Neill says, hola, como esta usted? And Sin Miller says, love the beard. I've had enough for like a year or something. Poppy Saver says, awesome. Cinder Fire says, bye, bye, Stephanie. So anyway, I know I haven't posted procedure videos. It's mostly because YouTube is always flagging my videos, always demonetizing, always making it harder for me to enjoy the experience of posting videos. And I haven't had any cool stuff. I mean, I've had some, and then I don't feel like getting the camera and stuff, and then I don't do it. So I'm sorry. I'll post more. I'll try to get them out there. So for now, I'm going to post other stuff. I'm going to do something like this where I talk about cases. I got some general medical health stuff. Maybe I'm kind of getting on a health kick. If you've noticed, I've lost some weight. I'm exercising. I'm getting some pecs and stuff like that. So I might do some exercise video, but not exercise video as in get tuned up and get all ripped. What about medical health? I'm 43 years old. I want to be strong. I want to live long. I want to live healthy. There's tons of stuff in the internet about use this, lose weight, do that. And I want to, on my own, see what works for me. And as I do that, maybe share it with you all, like, you know, exercise. You know, that's common sense, right? But diet, calorie counting, intermittent fasting or whatever. So thank you for joining. Thank you for spending Friday night with Dr. Carlo or Dr. ERTV. And hopefully you're enjoying the funny videos and the other stuff I'm